Hello and good morning, friends. Welcome to this CEC Edited Live Lecture. Dear friends, with our ongoing series on gender studies, today we will be talking on feminism in text. This is the topic which we would be covering, and this is the first part on feminism in text. And for this very discussion, we have once again with us in our studios Ms. Anaya Chaudhary. Ms. Anaya Chaudhary is an academic coordinator in CEC, and she has earlier also delivered a number of lectures. We believe that those lectures would have benefited you in understanding the series in detail. So let's welcome Ms. Anaya Chaudhary and let's try to understand the entire topic, feminism in text. Hello, Ms. Anaya Chaudhary. Welcome to the edited lecture.
Hello, Gitika. Hello, students. In today's session, I will be talking about feminism in text, part 1. Here, I will be talking about by referring primarily to an English author who is famously known as Virginia Woolf. And for that, I will be discussing her essay, A Room of One's Own. So I would recommend all the students that before actually going forward with my lecture, each of you should have a copy of that essay for a comprehensible way of understanding of what I will be talking about. So what I will be dealing with is to establish how feminism in Virginia Woolf's work plays an important role, and it can be traced in her various essays, biography that she wrote, various letters, and A Room of One's Own is a chief landmark essay that was written by her. Now, before immediately jumping on to A Room of One's Own, first I will be giving a gist about what feminism is. Though, if you look at my previous lectures, I have talked about the term in great depth. But here, for the convenience of the new audience who are viewing my lecture for the first time, I will be talking about feminism once more. So let us begin. So what exactly is feminism? Feminism is the advocacy of women's rights on the ground of the equality of the sexes. So in a sense, feminism is about one's right. Of course, an individual's right, a female's right. So it advocates women's right on the ground of equality of the sexes. The origin can be traced to the late 19th century from the French word, as mentioned, feminisme. I apologize for my pronunciation, but the origin, all you need to know, students, is that the origin can be traced from the French word. Now, for a greater understanding, let us try to see more aspects about feminism before I proceed, discussing Virginia Woolf and her famous essay. So, like I am saying, Toril Moy, in her famous essay, Feminist, Female and Feminine, she gives a very beautiful distinguishing between them. We distinguish between feminism as a political position, femaleness as a matter of biology, and femininity as a set of culturally defined characteristics. So what is Toril Moy trying to state here in her essay is that, so she talks about three terms, the feminist, the female, and the feminine, or the feminine. She states that feminism is something to do with the political ideology or the position. The femaleness, of course, is a matter of biology, and the femininity comes from socially and culturally defined characters. Now, in the similar way, there is another famous person, an entity known as Ellen Showalter, who plays a significant role when we deal with feminine studies. And she, in her work, A Literature of Their Own, British Women Novelists from Bronte to Lessing, she also talks about three periods. The first period is the feminine period, the second being the feminist period, and the third being the female period. Now, how are each of them, according to her, different? So for her, the feminine period begins with the use of male pseudonym in the 1840s. So what she's trying to state here is that during this time, a lot of female entities, this was the Victorian period, let us recall which period was it. During this time, a lot that was being written by female was usually under a pen name, which had a male name attached to it, under a male pen name. The pseudonym that was used was that of a male. Why? Because, of course, in Victorian period, the status of women was very different as to what it is in contemporary times. So they preferred writing in a certain kind of a pen name. So again, let us go back. The feminine is a period beginning with the use of male pseudonym in the 1840s until 1880s with George Eliot's death. In fact, George Eliot itself is a male pen name that has been used by a woman writer. Now, what was happening during this time was that there was an attempt, there was a strong attempt by the females to integrate themselves into the public sphere. And because they felt a sense of conflict of obedience as well as resistance. So there was a need by the female writers to write, but at the same time, be careful of the, be able to distinguish between the private and the public sphere that existed during that time. So they had to be obedient as well as, resist the kind of work that they were doing. So this was the feminine period. Because this was the Victorian period, so students, I would suggest you to also have know a gist about what Victorian period is about. And it is only then you will get a clearer understanding why the women of that time decided to write under male pen names. They adopted the names of males. Why was it happening? So this was happening during that time, and there was, of course, they were caught between a conflict of, like I stated, obedience and resistance. Now, the next period that Showalter talks about is the feminist. Now, this period, again, is important. It extends from 1880s till the winning of the rights of vote in the 1920s. Now, how is it different from the feminine period? Now, this becomes different from the feminine period because it speaks against the conventional and the traditional standards that have been set by the society, and it demands, there is a strong demand, that is, the works that have been written during this time establishes and depicts a strong demand of one's sovereignty and rights. So the feminist period is about one's sovereignty and rights. Now the third period, what is the third period? The third period is the female period. It extends from the 1920s to the contemporary, that is the present time, and it involves a sense of self-discovery and freedom. Now this period becomes very significant because, as we notice, there is a gradual progress. So in the first period, that is the feminine period, there was a sense of conflict between obedience and resistance. They had just started kind of writing, coming out into the open, into the public sphere through their works. In the second period, it was about demanding their sovereignty and rights. And in the third period, it was about self-discovery. So this aspect of self-discovery was not just from the outer aspect, that is, by involving themselves in various aspects of life, but also from within. There was a self-discovery, a sense of identifying what one stood for by the women writers from within. And that is, like I'm quoting, from some of the dependency of opposition. Freedom from some of the dependency of opposition. So that was an important aspect that one witnesses during this period, which was known as the female period. Now, many turned inwards in search of identity, like I have stated. So this is how each of the periods are different from each other. And primarily, the female period involved a sense of self-discovery and freedom from some of the dependency of opposition, where a lot of them looked within themselves to explore the various ideas and identities. The exploration of the self came into being. So these were the three periods. Now, let us move ahead. So now we've finally come to Virginia Woolf. Now, to keep it short, I will be discussing about a room of one's own, which was the landmark of 20th century feminist thought. She wrote several works, and each of them had certain aspects of where she vouched for equality of the sexes. And like in To the Lighthouse, which was written in 1927, she brings up one of the issues was the inequality that existed in the aspect of marriage, where she brilliantly presents the inequality because the characters of Mr. and Mrs. Ramsay was based on her parents. One can easily see the resemblance, and that is why through To the Lighthouse, by usage of various examples, she depicts the strong idea of the inequality that exists in marriages where the male has an upper hand to the female. Similarly, in one of her letters, she goes on to state where she again strongly speaks about that the man she married would be as worthy of her as she of him. They were to be equal partners. I mean, this letter itself speaks about the kind of vision that she she promises to uphold, and she promises to put forward in the society, not only through her own personal letters, but also through her works. So she stands for a sense of equality. She stands for non-biasing that exists in gender. So this is what it is about. Now, similarly, another of her works, The Moments of Being, which is a memoir, it appears that she was a victim of some kind of abuse that she had faced at the hands of one of her half-brothers. Now, this incident is important because this did have a strong impact on her mind, and it channeled the way she moved forward from that time onwards. And again, it reflects a sense of a common discrimination that exists, a common mindset that exists, where there is a tendency to discriminate against the female sex. Similarly, Mrs. Dalloway, through the use of the technique of stream of consciousness, beautifully portrays the character of Dalloway and depicts a lot of incidences where, again, she demonstrates the need of equality, a sense of non-discrimination that should exist in the society. Now, involved in contemporary women's movement, what I'm trying to state here is that she was also involved actively in various public movements which stood for equality of women's rights. Similarly, just like A Room of One's Own, she wrote several other essays, and I have mentioned here, she was not just a novelist, she was also an essayist, she was a biographer. So now, without wasting much time, let us finally begin with the essay, A Room of One's Own, which was a landmark and which became very famous because it talks about a sense of freedom that the women should instill within themselves and the society should embark upon them so that they can move strongly and proceed towards a better tomorrow. So let us begin. And I hope, students, now you have your text with you before we start with A Room of One's Own. Otherwise, it would become very difficult to catch up with the pace. So let us begin. Now, the book has one of the most significant lines that it opens with. So now, right now I'm beginning with part one. I have divided, like, the essay itself is divided into six parts. So now I'm beginning with part one. And how I will be progressing with the essay is that I will be taking up chief phrases in the essay, and at the same time talking about what she's trying to convey in her essay. What is the ideology? What is the essence of the whole essay? So the book, which begins with one of the most significant lines, let us not say exactly begin, but yes, it is above, right in the first of the paras, where she states, a woman must have money and a room of her own if she is to write fiction. And that, as you will see, leaves the great problem of the true nature of woman and the true nature of fiction unsolved. Now, what is she trying to state here? She is trying to state here that it is very important for a woman to have certain rights if she wants to write, if she wants to engage in the aspect of writing, a room of her one's own, some amount of money. But she feels that this is the main problem that exists in the society of that time, which was 1920s. And this is what she discusses, why there is a need for it and how it can help in improving the conditions of women. So this is a very important line. Now, again, I want to tell you one important thing, that a room of one's own is based on two papers read at Newnham and Girton, which were the two women's colleges, and that is how it came into being. She speaks about women and fiction here. The whole six parts, again, she tries to establish the relation that actually exists between women and fiction, and at the same time that how women were facing discrimination which prevented them from bringing out certain texts that existed during that time of the society, and that was the need of the hour. So let us move ahead. So what she says as one moves ahead, now I'm beginning with part one, she says that she imagines a fictionalized situation now. She imagines that now she is sitting on the banks of a river at Oxbridge. Now, Oxbridge again is a fictional university which is created from Oxford and Cambridge. And she decides and she openly states that now all the liberties and licenses of a novelist. Now, this is what she's going to take, the liberties and licenses of a novelist. Now, like I said, she imagines herself to be sitting near Oxbridge, and that is why she begins to think and ponder about this very situation, which talks about a room of one's own and why it is a necessity during that time. Now, again, as she is sitting on the riverside or on the lakeside, she notices that she comes up with an idea, and she immediately gets up and decides to roam about, when she is immediately stopped by a person who immediately comes to tell her that it is very important. Oxbridge is an invention, so is Fernham. This is what Virginia Woolf clearly states. I is only a convenient term for somebody who has no real being. Lies will flow from my lips, but there may perhaps be some truth mixed up with them. It is for you to seek out this truth and to decide whether any part of it is worth keeping. I had to come and go back to the phrase, a very important phrase that I had forgotten. What she's trying to say is that she imagines a fictionalized world where Oxbridge and Fernham are two fictionalized worlds. Fernham is more of a women's arena, and Oxbridge, of course, it is a male-centric arena. Like I said, she's sitting next to a river and she's thinking about an idea when she gets up, and instantly, like I'm quoting from here, instantly a man's figure rose to intercept me. Nor did I at first understand that the gesticulations of a curious looking object in a cutaway coat and evening shirt were aimed at me. His face expressed horror and indignation. Instinct rather than reason came to my help. He was a beadle, I was a woman. This was the turf, there was the path. Only the fellows and scholars are allowed here. The gravel is the place for me. Such thoughts were the work of a moment. And so clearly, as soon as she gets up and she starts to move around, she is made to remember, she is made an important individual, stops her from her thinking aspect, again hinting at a certain level of disturbance that exists in the women's everyday life, again disturbed by a male entity who reminds her that your position, like only the fellows and scholars are allowed here, and the gravel is the place for me. That is, you are meant to move on the gravel, which is the hard aspect. Again, symbolically trying to depict that a woman faces tougher situations in life, and for men it is the turf who can move around on the turf. Similarly, another incident in part one, which again depicts the sense of discrimination that exists, is that, you know, as soon as she reaches the library, she's immediately, stopped at the library, and a man immediately states to her that ladies are only admitted to the library if accompanied by a fellow of the college or furnished with a letter of introduction. Now again, these lines are very emphatic, because even though this is a fictionalized narrative that she's giving, but through every line she is depicting the sense of discrimination that exists against the women. They're not allowed to enter libraries, they're not allowed to work according to their needs, the ideas that come engaging them are immediately disturbed upon by the daily rituals, where they're usually interfered by the aspects of men, and where the men tends to have an upper hand. And in both the incidences, it was the men who intercepted her thought process. And again, she succeeds in establishing the kind of discrimination, the kind of differentiation that exists between both the sexes. Now, part one then moves on to a certain kind of lunch that takes place, and at this lunch, where she sees a metaphor of a cat, which is a cat without a tail, again is very emphatic, because something seemed lacking, something seemed different. This is what she's trying to establish here. And what was she trying to say here? Though completely not a feminist aspect that she's trying to reveal here, but she also addresses the idea of how the modern times have changed after the World War. The poetry that was written before the World War was much different from the poetry that began to be written after the World War. And that is why she uses the metaphor of a cat without a tail, that is, a sense of lacking. So the modern times lagged a certain sense of how the poetry began to be written, how things began to be addressed. They were very different times from the times before the war. Now, this was just an example I did not want to miss about, though in no way does it address any kind of relation to the feminist aspect. But again, like I said, whenever we are progressing with an essay, it is very important to not just approach with a certain ideology in mind, but to keep it a multidimensional approach and address all the various issues. So here again, she talks about the modern times and the Victorian times and how they were different from each other, or the Edwardian times that preceded the modern times, or to be more crisp, clear, the post-war and the pre-war time period. Now, another aspect where she talks about the aspect of the feminism aspect, where I'm talking about here, is that she brings about a strong and a sharp contrast between the lunch that took place at the university, which was of course Oxbridge, and that at Fernham. Now, there is a strong distinction between them. Now, Fernham is a ladies' institute. Now, she quotes, like I'm saying, that at Fernham, whereas the lunch at the Oxbridge was lavish. Lunch there was lavish, a lot of dishes were laid out, and complete luxury could be seen there. But the dinner there, let me quote, it was a plain gravy soup. There was nothing to stir the fancy in that. One could have seen through the transparent liquid any pattern that there might have been on the plate itself. Now again, this itself talks about the strong difference that existed in terms of maybe the finances that were available to them made them only afford so much as mentioned here in the text. And that is the clear distinction that she draws between the male and the female university. Now, again, she proceeds ahead. Then she talks about women's education, where she states that we are told that we ought to ask for £30,000 at least. It is not a large sum, considering that there is to be but one college of this sort for Great Britain, Ireland and the colonies, and considering how easy it is to raise immense sums for boys' schools. But considering how few people really wish women to be educated, it is a good deal. We burst out in scorn at the reprehensible poverty of our sex. Now, this again is very emphatic. What is she trying to state here? What is the part one? We are coming to an end towards the part one, but what is she trying to state here? There were issues of finance, there were issues of education. and the material aspects which a woman must need, that is a room of one's own, some money to write, to feel a sense of freedom, to feel a sense of aesthetic achievement, all of these aspects was missing. And this is what she's trying to address here, and she's given various instances through her fictionalized narrative here. So women's education, again, like the statement states, that there were hardly any expenditure, any finances which could help them address the expenditure issues of the women's university, because hardly few people really wish women to be educated. So clearly she comes out with the fact. So clearly she establishes the hierarchy, the positional hierarchy of the women during those times. And in fact, throughout this part one, there is a lot of imagery of light and fire also that she brings into the focus, which is a sense of aesthetic purification that she talks about. And what again she's trying to state here is that food, education and money, these are the three aspects which are a must. That is, the basic materialistic things of one's life are a necessity for an individual, particularly women, to go forth with the idea of writing their works. So this was about part one. Now let us proceed to part two, which again takes up from where we left. Now part two, the scene shifts from Oxbridge to London. Now, when the scene shifts from Oxford to London, she's constantly thinking about the questions that she wanted to address during the, which she witnessed during the previous days. So, what were these questions about? The questions were, why did men drink wine and women water? Why was one sex so prosperous and the other so poor? What effect has poverty on fiction? What conditions are necessary for the creation of works of art? 1,000 questions at once suggested themselves. So again, you know, she's constantly pondering over the thoughts from the fictionalized narrative. Now again, why did she go for a fictionalized narrative? The idea was to, promote a sense of objectifying the whole approach towards the discrimination that existed. She wanted to have an objective approach towards it. She did not want to be seen to be somebody who's approaching it because she herself is a woman and, you know, she's, subjectively addressing the issues. She wanted to approach it with a very objective mindset. And that is why for a clearer understanding, she brings in a fictionalized narrative so that it becomes clear not only for herself or for the readers, but for the entire society as a whole, that these aspects exist in our daily lives too. So now let us go back to chapter 2. So like she shifts her from Oxbridge to London, she thinks about the question raised during the previous day, and she decides to go to the museum where she goes through the catalogues to see how many works have been written on women. And she also notices how many works have been written on male, and she finds that hardly anything has been written on the male entity. She selects few of these books which speak of women in a negative tone, and that is itself very important. Now, what I'm trying to state here is that women do not write books about men. And again, there is an emphatic idea what she's trying to convey here is that the lot of work which had been written about women in a not very positive tone was written in the red light of emotion and not in the white light of truth. And this is what the writer perhaps is trying to convey to us here, is that this idea of anger or the very aspects that had been written about women were more to do with one's emotion about the kind of comparison which prompted the men to and made them feel superior. It was only after they viewed women as inferior could they feel superior. Women, as quoted in the text, as you can see in part two, were like a mirror to men. And that was a way, by showing them as being inferior, could they feel themselves to be at the higher position in the hierarchy of the society. So we have reached the mid of chapter 2 and or the part 2, but let us just ponder over some ideas, and perhaps in the next session I will be picking up from the middle of part 2 and then progressing till part 6. So for now, students, we discussed about the basic ideas, the tenets of feminism. I spoke about the essay A Room of One's Own and how it is a landmark essay in the during the society that of that time, as well as it is a landmark essay even in contemporary times, and how it is very important to study it, to see how the idea of feminism is important in contemporary times. Students, in the next session, we will take forward from the middle of chapter 2. Till then, thank you and goodbye. Hello students, in the last session I spoke about tenets of feminism and the how of Virginia Woolf and her essay played an emphatic role and continues to play a similar significant role in contemporary times because of the landmark essay that she wrote, primarily known as The Room of One's Own. And I had discussed part 1 and part 2 in detail and the important phrases in it to chart out what is significant with the can be viewed as a feminist approach, and how Virginia Woolf talks about the distinction that exists in the society between male and the female. And the emphatic and the one of the most emphatic statements that she makes during part 1, that a woman must have a room of one's own. Now, I had left it midway between part 2 so that you could have a clearer understanding, and I felt it would become a bit exhaustive to try to end all the parts in the previous session. That's why I divided the session into two parts. And now I will begin from the middle of part 2. But for that, I will just give you a gist of what we did in part 2. So in part 2, I spoke about the idea of anger that exists in the society, as it appears that the male portray women in a not a very positive light. They view women as inferior to them. And why this idea of anger exists is what Virginia Woolf is trying to address. So for Virginia Woolf, let me quote, "Possibly when the professor insisted a little too emphatically upon the inferiority of women, he was concerned not with their inferiority, but with his own superiority." And that is what she's trying to state here, that for them, that is the men, to feel superior, it was significant for a dichotomy that could be established, where the women were seen as inferior, and it was only by that comparison could they feel themselves to be better than the fairer sex. Now, the next point that Virginia Woolf speaks about is the idea of inheritance, which immediately shifts our focus. I request the students to look at part two again, where I am dealing with these ideas and where I am discussing part two of a room of one's own. Let us look at it. So the idea of inheritance becomes important. So as she progresses through the chapter or the part two, she states that the society gives me chicken and coffee, bed and lodging, in return for a certain number of pieces of paper which were left to me by an aunt for no other reason than that I share her name. So it was, she feels that these materialistic aspects were only given to her because she had a certain amount of money that were left to her by her aunt. Now this aspect itself is very motivating, and the kind of idea that she is again trying to convey to the readers is how the idea of inheritance should not just be restricted to the male child, but can also be given to a female child. This is a slight idea that she's trying to convey here, but more importantly, the idea that is being conveyed here is that it is the aspect of monetary issue, it is the aspect of money that makes one feel empowered. It are these materialistic things that makes one feel empowered, and that's how she takes forward from part one, where again she says that a room of one's own and some money are a necessity, and it is only then can one feel a certain aesthetic freedom and intellectual freedom and be able to write or be able to feel a sense of empowerment, freedom. So this is what she says. Again, in the next line, as we see, one notices that she makes another important statement, that the idea of freedom is echoed here. Freedom to think of things in themselves. Indeed, my aunt's legacy unveiled the sky to me and substituted for the large and imposing figure of a gentleman. So this is what she's saying, that these materialistic things, they not only give you a sense of freedom in terms of writing something, in terms of other aspects, but also to be less dependent on the male entity, to be less dependent on the opposite sex. Now, as we progress further, we noted another idea that has been echoed here, that is the idea of division of labor. Now, this is again important. What she tries to convey here, let us try to understand. Please listen carefully. That she tries to say here, the idea of division of labor is constantly undergoing a change. There is a transition in the idea of division of labor. And she also importantly puts forward an important issue that the domestic labor that is being performed by a woman cannot be valued against the labor that is being performed, of course, chiefly by the male entities in the public sphere. So what she's trying to convey here, that it is difficult to provide a value to the labor that is being performed both in the private and the public sphere. And she gives two reasons for it. One, because economically it is difficult to measure the domestic labor. And secondly, that culturally and at the societal aspect, it is undergoing constant change. So to measure it or to value that which labor is better, the one which is performed in the interiors of the household, the private arena, or the one that is performed in the public sphere. And this is what she's trying to state here. Now, another important aspect that she's trying to address here is the whole idea of hope. Hope becomes very important, for she says that she hopes that the future has no such division. She feels that there is a sense again of equality. Again, she's advocating a sense of equal rights for women, and such that this division of labor that exists during the society, and in fact it even exists today, in the future does not at all exist or is reduced in comparison to the one that exists in the contemporary times of the society that Virginia Woolf lived in. So idea of division of labor with changing times, logically they will take part in all the activities and exertions that were once denied them. So, you know, what she's trying to say that with the changing times, they will eventually take part in areas that were once denied to them. In fact, we see that today. In fact, in the previous session, I spoke about show alters, differentiation of the three time periods. And we see the transgression that has taken place. That is because of the cultural transition that has taken place with the society. Now, this is what she talks about in part two. Again, another important aspect is that fictionalizing her essay, like I discussed before, gave her a sense of viewing it with a distance, gave her a sense of giving it an objective approach. And that is very important. Now, let us come to part three. Now, what is happening in part three is, as she's progressed from part one to part two and finally to part three, she talks about and wants to trace the kind of, you know, how women were treated at a certain point of time. Now, she in part three, one notices that now she's returned home and now she looks at the lives of various English writers, and she notices that the women, as has been discussed in the text, are very much different to what they exist as in reality. Now, again, this is very important. So she's talking about the Elizabethan age, where she states, "For it is a perennial puzzle why no woman wrote a word of that extraordinary literature when every other man, it seemed, was capable of song or sonnet." So constantly she's trying to arouse in the mind of the readers various questions. Why certain things were not happening? Why women were not granted certain rights? Why were they not able to write? What was the reason? And constantly throughout her parts, she's trying to address it with a proper approach, with a fictionalized narrative, which she offers to us. Now, the idea of powerlessness is also what she explores in part three. Let me quote from part three. "Once more, I looked up women, found position of and turned to the pages indicated wife beating. I read was a recognized right of man and was practiced without shame by high as well as low." Similarly, the historian goes on, "The daughter who refused to marry the gentleman of her parents' choice was liable to be locked up, beaten and flung about the room without any shock being inflicted on public opinion." Such an important statement she makes here. She not only charts chronologically or the position that existed, the pitiable status of the women during the Elizabethan time, but also demonstrates powerfully the kind of distinction that existed between both the sexes. There was wife beating, they had no rights of their own. They had to marry according to their parents' choice and so on. So now again, the idea of paradox is again what she's trying to suggest here, because as you will notice, as you will read part three, she states that imaginatively, she's of the highest importance. Why is she saying that? Because of course, maybe in the various works that have been written, she has been portrayed in a certain manner in contrast to what she exists in the real times, in the real society, the real world. So let me move forward. Imaginatively, she's of the highest importance. Practically, she's completely insignificant. She parades poetry from cover to cover. She's all but absent from history. Again, very strongly putting her argument about the position that existed regarding the women of those times. The women of those times faced extreme amount of discrimination. They existed almost as non-entities. Look at the strong terms that Virginia Woolf is using here. But absent from history. So she was almost absent. It was only imaginatively that she was of the highest importance. But in reality, she was almost absent from the history. Let me move forward. That is why she goes on to say, when she talks about the Elizabethan period, that with the kind of position that women occupied, it would have been impossible completely and entirely for any woman to have written the plays of Shakespeare in the age of Shakespeare. Why is she saying that? Why couldn't have a woman written play with the same caliber, of the same level as the renowned author Shakespeare? That's because the kind of discrimination she faced. But to further provide a better understanding, to comprehend it in a more correct manner, what she does is she imagines her sister to be known as Judith. So she says, what would have happened had Shakespeare had a wonderfully gifted sister called Judith? Let us see. So he imagines a role, a character who is Shakespeare's sister with the name Judith. Now, students, this part is again very important because here she tries to demonstrate powerfully that in all hierarchies, in upper class as well as in all types of classes, in all types of hierarchies, it was a woman who faced a lot of discrimination, including Shakespeare's, if there was one, very own sister. So again, don't forget, Judith is only an imaginary entity. She uses Judith to talk about the discrimination that women faced during that time. Why? Now let me quote from here. Meanwhile, his extraordinarily gifted sister, let us suppose, remained at home. She was as adventurous, as imaginative, as egoic to see the world as he was. But she was not sent to school. She had no chance of learning grammar and logic, let alone of reading Horace and Virgil. She picked up a book now and then, one of her brothers perhaps, and read a few pages. But then her parents came in and told her to mend the stockings or mind the stew and not moon about with books and papers. They would have spoken sharply but kindly, for they were substantial people who knew the conditions of life for a woman. So again, you know, what is she trying to state here? That Judith herself would not really get the amount of freedom that Shakespeare as a writer would get. She would be encouraged not to engage in writings or read books, but she was in fact encouraged, as stated by her parents, to engage in household chores, household duties, to restrict herself to domestic life. And let me go ahead with it. So this is, again, students, let me repeat, this is part three. And in part three, she is, Virginia Woolf, is talking about the discrimination that is being faced by women since, not just in the contemporary times, but she traces it chronologically. And here she's talking about Elizabethan age, where she picks up the role of Judith, which is imaginary female character imagined to be the sister of Shakespeare, and she tries to analyze that if Shakespeare had a sister known as Judith, what kind of would she be able to write? Would she get the same sense of freedom as Shakespeare? So let me quote another para here. Perhaps she scribbled some pages up in an apple loft on the sly, but was careful to hide them or set fire to them. Soon, however, before she was out of her teens, she was to be betrothed to the son of a neighboring wool stapler. She cried out that marriage was hateful to her, and for that she was severely beaten by her father. Then he ceased to scold her. He begged her instead not to hurt him, not to shame him in this matter of her marriage. And eventually, let me quote, she killed herself one winter's night and lies buried at some crossroads. Such a pitiable state of a woman during the Elizabethan times. And how beautifully Virginia Woolf speaks about it, how strongly she demonstrates the discrimination that existed. And in fact, she's also trying to say that because the society worked in a certain manner, the parents, even if they loved her, had to make her behave in a certain manner. But because she was rebellious, and she decided to kill herself because she did not want to get married, or she eventually was so overcome powerfully by the kind of restrictions that were imposed upon her that she was eventually killed. And look at the line, and she lies buried at some crossroads. The kind of disinterestedness that with which Virginia Woolf conveys this idea again shows the, you know, grim situation and the grim reality that women face. That even if, when she is lying buried, even after her death, there is no relevance of her death. And she just lies buried at some crossroads. So another important issue that in part 3 she tries to address is that as you analyze part 3, now again I want to repeat that I would recommend that each of you first read each part and then progress with me as I'm progressing with the ideas. This would help you to establish in a very comprehensive manner what I am talking about and give a clear perspective of the various ideas to you that I'm dealing with. Because if you approach with me without having the book open in front of you, it would become very difficult to understand what I'm quoting from the text or what I'm trying to convey, the ideas I'm trying to echo regarding Virginia Woolf. So please refer to the text and then refer to my lecture for a better understanding. So inner conflict of a woman is another issue that one sees in part 3, which she talks about, as she clearly states. You know, Virginia Woolf, throughout the essay, there are a lot of questions throughout the essays. And this, again, itself keeps the readers and the audience very engaged. So another question which she talks about, when she talks about the inner conflict of a woman, she states, what is the state of mind that is most propitious to the act of creation? What does she mean by the word propitious? Propitious. It means favorable. So what is she saying, that in what kind of state of mind can one possibly write or produce a certain act of creation, produce a certain creation? And she gives a beautiful answer to it. She states that mind must be incandescent, there must be no obstacle in it, no foreign matter unconsumed. Now this again is very important. But is the woman getting those rights? Is the woman able to reach to that level? Can she get into that incandescent state? No, of course not. As we have progressed through the parts 1, 2 and 3, we notice that is not possible and that is very rare that it's happening. So this is what she's saying. And again, echoing the ideas that she addresses in each of the part 1, 2 and 3, that woman must have a room of one's own, a certain sense of freedom, certain material benefits in the sense of money, education, finances to further support, integrate her with the rest of the society and provide her with certain rights that she desires to bring her at par with men and to help her to produce a certain creation, to help her achieve an aesthetic experience. She needs all of those aspects. So, these are the things which she's talking about, and you can divide the basic material, the basic necessities into both the social requirements and the materialistic requirements. So she also needs the support of the society, not just the material requirements. There is also need for certain support from the society, and that is why she's constantly echoing the idea of incandescence. So incandescence, perhaps you can, in a very layman's language, it means, the light from the heat. And this intensity of art can only be achieved. And, with reference to part 3, I think incandescence can stand for the intensity of art. You can take it as intensity of art. And what she's trying to say is that this intensity of the art can only be achieved when she gets a certain sense of freedom through various material benefits or the material privileges that she constantly desires. Now, when we, come to part 4, let us come to part 4. So, chapter 4, she traces various women. Like, as you can see, she notices the progress of various women writers. Now, here again, before at the starting of the chapter, what is interesting about Virginia Woolf is that she links all the parts very well. So she kind of ended with the idea of incandescence, and again she begins with the idea of incandescence as a state of mind which is impossible for a woman to achieve in the 16th century. And then she takes forward the idea that she tries to convey in part 4. Now, in part 4, she traces the emergence of women writers. Now, what is she trying to convey here? She's trying to convey here various ideas, which after discussing each of them, I will be discussing as a commentary at the end of when I finish discussing part 4. So she begins by discussing the aristocratic women who have the freedom and the comfort And through the, for this, she takes the example of Lady Winchelsea. So people like Lady Winchelsea, who are the aristocratic women, have a certain kind of freedom and comfort. Similarly, Margaret of Newcastle. Again, she is aristocratic. She has no children. Again, they have a certain kind of freedom. There is no sense of, not so much of restriction, and they're able to write. But again, you know, she, when you read through chapter 4 or the part 4, it seems that Wolfe is not very impressed by her work. Next, he talks about the letters of Dorothy Osborne. This is followed by the most significant woman writer, which has a deep influence of Virginia Woolf, and this is Aphrabin. Now, Aphrabin is the woman which she feels is the turning point of the works that was being written, because she's a middle-class woman and she writes to earn a living. And she writes by defying the conventions. She does not belong to aristocratic lifestyle. She's a middle-class woman. She has a limited sources of income, and still she decides to write and defy the traditional conventional established ideas of those times, as she decides to write as a woman during that time. So many were inspired from her, as she quotes, "All women together ought to let flowers fall upon the tomb of Aphrabin, for it was she who earned them the right to speak their minds." How beautifully does Virginia Woolf conveys this idea? She's indebted to Aphrabin and her writing, because she feels it was the turning point was Aphrabin's writing, which played an important role in influencing, in encouraging the woman to catch hold of pens and begin to write. Now, another important aspect that she's trying to address here is that when the work was being written, most of the women writers adopted the novelist form. Now, why did the women writers adopt the novelist form? Now, though, again, you know, I said in the last session that I will also be talking about various other ideas, in a rough way, but chiefly my focus is to talk about feminism in text, which is the topic of that I'm discussing here. But yet at the same time, I'm not going to ignore the important ideas, other ideas that come across the work. So this is another idea, that why did the women adopt the novelist form? So she clearly states that they perhaps adopted the novelist form because they wrote in a shared sitting room. They wrote between people where there was certain kind of distraction. So it was nearly impossible to engage in the sense of writing a poetry. So this was one of the reasons that is being cited by Woolf. Now, another important reason that Woolf cites is that, you know, there was no formal literary training. One could not, women of those times could not get a formal literary training. And similarly, another important aspect that she talks about is that the younger from, since the novelist was a very young form, it was still progressing, there were still certain changes that were taking place in the novel form. So that is why they adopted to it. Poetry or other aspects were, many of them were clearly established, had certain rules and regulations to be followed. And since women were new to literary writings, they engaged in writing novels. And another important aspect is that she decides to compare Austen to Shakespeare, who wrote in a way that her art consumed all impediments. So she gives very significant information in talking about that women, when they begin to write, they are no less than men. They're no less than male writers, and that is what she's trying to convey here. Part 4 also talks about various other ideas, like the idea of integrity and sex, where she talks about that, you know, Charlotte Bronte, there is visible, the integrity is visible, but, there is a certain sense of uncomfortableness that she views when in Bronte's writing. But she feels Austen and Bronte maintain integrity even in the face, that is Emily Bronte, and the above one is Charlotte Bronte. She feels Austen and Bronte maintain integrity in the face of criticism, opposition. So, you know, this is what she's talking about here. And, you know, another important aspect that she talks about in part 4 is how there is a lack of literary tradition. Now, this issue has been talked about in a lot of other essays, and this issue of lack of literary tradition. Why does she talk about the lack of literary tradition, and what is she trying to reflect here? What she tries to reflect here through the lack of literary tradition is that, you know, women have nothing to fall back upon. They did not have, female writers who were writing, and so, you know, that is why there was a lack of proper literary tradition. There was no sense of flow. And that is why, you know, you can also refer to anxiety of authorship as well as anxiety of influence. In fact, anxiety of authorship gives a clear idea of Gilbert and Goober, which is very important. Now, this will give you perhaps a proper understanding of what it is. Finally, if I have to speak about parts 5 and part 6, I would suggest that we should take it forward to the next session, because this is very significant. Part 5 and part 6 again is very significant when one is looking at a room of one's own. So what I'm going to do in the next session is I will be discussing part 5 as well as part 6, and also go to the next topic, that is Feminism in Text part 2, where I'll be talking about some Indian writer, the approach which is taken by Indian writer in talking about feminism. And that is why, students, I hope you enjoyed today's session. And for any queries and doubts, please put it below and let me know. Thank you very much.
We would like to thank Ms. Anaya Chaudhary once again for giving us a very, very productive session. And dear friends, if you have any queries or if you want to give your feedback for this particular lecture, then you can mail us at info.cc@nic.in. We would be meeting again very soon. Till then, take care. Goodbye. Thank you, Ms. Anaya. Thanks so very much.
Thank you.